Good evening and welcome to the public worship service of St. John's Presbyterian Church, Annerley, with our own pastor, Reverend Martin Duffield, ministering this evening. Please now take a moment to quietly prepare prior to the call to worship. Thank you.
Let's worship God. Our call to worship comes from the 19th chapter of the book of the Revelation and verses 5 and 6. And a voice came from the throne saying, "Praise our God, all you his servants, and those who fear him, both small and great." And I heard, as it were, a voice out of a great multitude, as the sound of many waters, and as the sound of mighty thundering, saying, "Hallelujah, for the Lord God omnipotent reigns." Let's adore him in prayer. Almighty God, the great God of heaven and earth, the God of all the nations, what a privilege it is for us to know the future, to be able to see your plan and purpose as it has been worked out and will be worked out in the pages of Scripture and especially in prophecy. What a glory it is to you for us to see the mystery of the ages, that precious mystery of the ages revealed in Christ, who is the hope, with the hope of the gospel for both Jew and Gentile alike. We acknowledge before you tonight that the gods of men are but local gods, fictional gods, created in the image of men, faulty, frail, and impotent like their makers. But you, our God, are from everlasting to everlasting. You are the wisdom of the ages, the source of all living things and all light, and everything holds together in heaven and earth by your mighty hand alone. And for this and a multitude of other reasons, we have come in this evening hour to pay you homage for your greatness and to glorify your name and to seek your face and your mercies in our worship. O Father, all glorious, who can stay your hand? Who can thwart your will? What promise of yours can fail while you will enact in the midst of creation as you do? Your mighty deeds are yet another source of our praise and thanksgiving, and especially as those deeds pertain to the redemption of our souls through the incarnate Son of God. So help us to worship and glorify you tonight. Remind us of your great plan for history and your presence and purpose in carrying it out. Glorify yourself in this portion of the Word of God and give us understanding of its precious treasures of wisdom and knowledge and insight. And fill our mouth with praise, increased praise, as you fill our minds with wonder, and as you secure our peace through a complete and childlike trust in your grace and your power. And these things we pray in our Lord Jesus' name as we seek your face and your favour in worship tonight. Amen. We're going to sing from the 48th Psalm, "Great is Jehovah."
Amen.
Because it's such a long reading, we're going to just read the first part, the first 23 verses of Daniel 2, and then later on we'll read the second part. So Daniel chapter 2.
So Daniel chapter 2, and in our first reading we'll just read to verse 23. Beginning at verse 1. Now in the second year of Nebuchadnezzar's reign, Nebuchadnezzar had dreams, and his spirit was so troubled that his sleep left him. Then the king gave the command to call the magicians, the astrologers, the sorcerers, and the Chaldeans to tell the king his dreams. So they came and stood before the king. And the king said to them, "I have had a dream, and my spirit is anxious to know the dream." Then the Chaldeans spoke to the king in Aramaic, "O king, live forever. Tell your servants the dream, and we will give the interpretation." The king answered and said to the Chaldeans, "My decision is firm. If you do not make known the dream to me and its interpretation, you shall be cut in pieces and your houses shall be made an ash heap. However, if you tell the dream and its interpretation, you shall receive from me gifts, rewards, and great honor. Therefore, tell me the dream and its interpretation." They answered again and said, "Let the king tell his servants the dream, and we will give its interpretation." The king answered and said, "I know for certain that you would gain time, because you see that my decision is firm. If you do not make known the dream to me, there is only one decree for you. For you have agreed to speak lying and corrupt words before me, till the time has changed. Therefore, tell me the dream, and I shall know that you can give me its interpretation." The Chaldeans answered the king and said, "There is not a man on earth who can tell the king's matter. Therefore, no king, lord, or ruler has ever asked such things of any magician, astrologer, or Chaldean. It is a difficult thing that the king requests, and there is no other who can tell it to the king except the gods, whose dwelling is not with flesh." For this reason the king was angry and very furious, and gave the command to destroy all the wise men of Babylon. So the decree went out, and they began killing the wise men, and they sought Daniel and his companions to kill them. Then with counsel and wisdom, Daniel answered Arioch, the captain of the king's guard, who had gone out to kill the wise men of Babylon. He answered and said to Arioch, the king's captain, "Why is the decree from the king so urgent?" Then Arioch made the decision known to Daniel. So Daniel went in and asked the king to give him time, that he might tell the king the interpretation. Then Daniel went to his house and made the decision known to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, his companions, that they might seek mercies from God, the God of heaven, concerning this secret, so that Daniel and his companions might not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Then the secret was revealed to Daniel in a night vision. So Daniel blessed the God of heaven. Daniel answered and said, "Blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his. And he changes the times and the seasons. He removes kings and raises up kings. He gives wisdom to the wise, and knowledge to those who have understanding. He reveals deep and secret things. He knows what is in the darkness, and light dwells with him. I thank you and praise you, O God of my fathers. You have given me wisdom and might, and have now made known to me what we asked of you, for you have made known to us the king's demand. Amen.
Let's pray. Our gracious Father in heaven, well did the Lord Jesus say to his disciples, O ye of little faith. How easily are we, on the one hand, so quickly discouraged by the little that we see around us. We look at our meager resources and we compare them to the greatness of the task, and we are quickly brought to despair. How forgetful are we of history and scripture, which testify to the faithfulness of God and the power of God in times of human meagerness and weakness. How many times do we forget what others have testified to in the past in remarkable deliverances and wonderful provisions and stunning providences? Oh, we have little faith. On the other hand, we know that men are prone to brag about their greatness and their skill, until in their folly they injure or kill, or they damage or destroy. And other men are prone to brag about their power and their capacities, until the far greater powers of creation in storm and wind and fire and seas come and drive them to helplessness and leave them bereft of property and even life. We know that the greatness of men is but a weakness that is imagined into greatness by pride. So as we come to consider your great power and your wisdom tonight, teach us to avoid these two errors of arrogance and despair. Let our trust rest securely in what you can do. Let it strengthen us because of what you have done, and because of what you will do for those who trust you. Remind us often of your countless acts of greatness in the past, that we might find encouragement and approach the future with a humble trust. Teach us especially not to trust the arm of flesh, the wisdom of ignorant men. Grant us perception and insight instead into your great ways, that we might access them as families and churches and even nations. Let the blessed influence of your Spirit, your Word, your Kingdom permeate our society, and especially our churches, that you may work your power through us rather than we working in our own weakness. This we pray in our Lord Jesus' name this evening. Amen. We're going to sing 318, Your Kingdom Come, O God.
Thank you.
God, and we'll take the second reading from Daniel 2:24 to hear of the prophecy of this event.
So now continuing on in verse 24 of Daniel chapter 2. Therefore Daniel went to Arioch, whom the king had appointed to destroy the wise men of Babylon. He went and said thus to him, "Do not destroy the wise men of Babylon. Take me before the king, and I will tell the king the interpretation." Then Arioch quickly brought Daniel before the king and said thus to him, "I have found a man of the captives of Judah who will make known to the king the interpretation." The king answered and said to Daniel, whose name was Belteshazzar, "Are you able to make known to me the dream which I have seen and its interpretation?" Daniel answered in the presence of the king and said, "The secret which the king has demanded the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, and the soothsayers cannot declare to the king. But there is a God in heaven who reveals secrets, and he has made known to King Nebuchadnezzar what will be in the latter days. Your dream and the visions of your head upon your bed were these. As for you, O king, thoughts came to your mind while on your bed about what would come to pass after this. And he who reveals secrets has made known to you what will be. But as for me, this secret has not been revealed to me because I have more wisdom than anyone living, but for our sakes who make known the interpretation to the king, and that you may know the thoughts of your heart. You, O king, were watching, and behold, a great image. This great image, whose splendor was excellent, stood before you, and its form was awesome. This image's head was of fine gold, its chest and arms of silver, its belly and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly of iron and partly of clay. You watched while a stone was cut out without hands, which struck the image on its feet of iron and clay and broke them in pieces. Then the iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver, and the gold were crushed together and became like chaff from the summer threshing floors. The wind carried them away so that no trace of them was found. And the stone that struck the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. This is the dream. Now we will tell the interpretation of it before the king. You, O king, are a king of kings. For the God of heaven has given you a kingdom, power, strength, and glory. And wherever the children of men dwell, or the beasts of the field and the birds of the heaven, he has given them into your hand and has made you ruler over them all. You are this head of gold. But after you shall arise another kingdom, inferior to yours. Then another, a third kingdom of bronze, which shall rule over all the earth. And the fourth kingdom shall be as strong as iron, inasmuch as iron breaks in pieces and shatters everything. And like iron that crushes, that kingdom will break in pieces and crush all the others. Whereas you saw the feet and toes partly of potter's clay and partly of iron, the kingdom shall be divided. Yet the strength of the iron shall be in it, just as you saw the iron mixed with ceramic clay. And as the toes of the feet were partly of iron and partly of clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly fragile. As you saw iron mixed with ceramic clay, they will mingle with the seed of men, but they will not adhere to one another, just as iron does not mix with clay. And in the days of these kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people. It shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. Inasmuch as you saw that the stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, and that it broke in pieces the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold, the great God has made known to the king what will come to pass after this. The dream is certain, and its interpretation is sure. Then King Nebuchadnezzar fell on his face, prostrate before Daniel, and commanded that they should present an offering and incense to him. The king answered Daniel and said, "Truly, your God is the God of gods, the Lord of kings, and a revealer of secrets, since you could reveal this secret." Then the king promoted Daniel and gave him many great gifts, and he made him ruler over the whole province of Babylon and chief administrator over all the wise men of Babylon. Also, Daniel petitioned the king, and he set Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego over the affairs of the province of Babylon. But Daniel sat in the gate of the king. May the Lord bless the reading of his word to us. Amen.
Let's worship God now as we humble ourselves before him and meditate upon his goodness, and then thank him for the offerings that we bring through the week and tonight. Take our gifts this evening, as you've taken them through the week, and use them to grow that glorious kingdom of God that is now on earth. And though it is even now a great kingdom on its own, bigger than any single nation by far, and bigger than any transnational organisation, may it please you to continue to expand its glorious influences through these humble gifts. We pray this in our Saviour's glorious and blessed name, the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. We shall sing again to God's praise, 260, "Your kingdom come on bended knee."
Thank you.
Lord our God, we do thank you for again for the word of God which has come to us, and we are thrilled to be able to hear again one of the most remarkable pieces of literature ever written, which spoke not only of centuries of history that is now complete, fulfilling to the letter the word of the dream of this great ancient king, but also, as we are shown in the dream, the birth of the other kingdom, the greatest kingdom, which we now see having grown all around us and growing into the future into a greater and a greater transnational empire. So help us to understand our Lord's parable concerning its growth, and may we learn much from it and be encouraged through it, for we ask it in our Lord Jesus' name. Amen. So I'm just going to read to you just, it's two verses from Matthew. Don't bother opening the scriptures. It's the parable of the mustard seed from Matthew 13, 31 and 32. Another parable he put forth to them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed which a man took and sowed in his field, which is indeed the least of all the seeds, but when it is grown, it is greater than the herbs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and nest in its branches. So, a simple parable, just a couple of lines that our Lord gave to the apostles, the disciples at the time. And we're looking at this subject tonight, this parable under the history of the mystery of the kingdom's growth. So let's begin. The history of the church, which begins with the history of Adam and Eve, is a story of small beginnings and large ends. An overview of Scripture's great ages tells us this. The church, like the humanity in which it subsists, is a living thing, and healthy living things will grow naturally. When God used the words, be fruitful and multiply, as with all the commands, they were preceded by the words, and God blessed them. And so anything God blesses, prospers. It flourishes, it grows. Anything of any kind, physical or spiritual, animal or vegetable, individual or corporate, will so grow. Growth is the sign of life and health, and it is often a sign of divine approval and energizing. So too the opposite is true. When things atrophy or wither, die, it is often a sign of withdrawal of divine blessing and energy, especially the Holy Spirit's energy, whether for an individual or a group, whether for churches or nations. But tonight the parable of mustard seeds, as it is commonly called, gives us the ultimate example or illustration of the relationship between the blessing and infused energy of God and the expansion of the host of that blessing and energy, in this case the kingdom. The purpose of the parable might not be stated or obvious, but it is my conviction that it is meant as an encouragement to the church in times of trouble and decline. One implication of the reality of the growth of the kingdom comes from the Reverend Graham Nicholson, one of our own ministers, who said in a sermon several decades ago, did you know that the church never gets smaller? It only ever grows. Here in heaven, the church only ever grows. And that's what this parable and Daniel 2:44 remind us about. This is the message of the mustard tree, of the ever-growing kingdom. Now the parable breaks up nice and easily into three distinct thoughts concerning origins, destiny, and legacy. So let's consider these three aspects of the mystery of the kingdom's growth in that order in this little parable. So it's tiny origins. The Lord begins with these words as he reveals the mystery of the nature of the growth of the kingdom. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed, which a man took and sowed in his field, which is indeed the least of all the seeds. Of course, the truth of this reality of tiny beginnings is well known to us. Although the kingdom of God existed before Christ came, his arrival heralded a great change in the nature of the kingdom, that it would ultimately become universal through the gospel, being made up now not just of Jews with a few Gentiles, but Jews and Gentiles together in large numbers. There were some Gentiles in the Old Covenant expression of the Kingdom of God and the nation state of Israel, but now the new nation state of spiritual Israel, as Peter tells us in 1 Peter 2:9-10, is the worldwide church made up of people from every nation, tribe and tongue. Coming back to the mustard seed, as some of you may know, it's a very small seed, about 2 to 3 millimeters, I think. You can plant many small seeds like this, especially vines like pumpkins or choco, and you'll be amazed at how large it can grow, to the point where it becomes a pest sometimes. There is a famous saying in America which is a proverb on this matter of potential growth from the tiny beginnings, from an essay by a man named D. Everett in the Columbian Orator in the year 1797. He said, "Large streams from little fountains flow, and tall oaks from little acorns grow." So how small was the kingdom when it began? Well, some would argue that it began with one man, the Lord, Jesus Christ. Some say it began with a handful of the men in his disciples, and some would say that it was the 120 disciples in Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost. It doesn't really matter. The point is, it began very, very small. What does this tell us? But that to God, the size of an organism is not critical to his plans or capacities. He began the universe, of course, with nothing. In Adam and Eve, he began with two, and he filled the whole ancient world with we don't know how many, hundreds of thousands or millions of people. In Abraham, he began with two also, and he produced the nation eventually with as many people as there were sands of the sea or stars in the sky. It was fulfilled in Solomon's day. In fact, he told Moses in his wrath against disobedient Israel that he could destroy the entire Exodus nation and begin over from the start with Moses and his wife. The scholars point to many small things that God was pleased to bless, to energize and to fructify. Speak of the tiny seed of the knowledge of God and how when it's sown into a person's life it grows into an enormous personal treasure of not only wisdom but faith. Speaks of the humble beginnings of many great servants of the Word of God. Most congregations and denominations also grow from very small, sometimes even from one person. I know one church in this very city which started from one family of five people. It grew into a house church of 37, and today it is a church of several congregations with perhaps 1,000 or more people. And that's, of course, part of the reason why our dear brother John Mercer used to encourage his students occasionally by quoting Zechariah 4:10, "For who has despised the day of small things?" And that text, by the way, referred to the return from exile and the state of the nation and the temple, where Israel was actually beginning from ruin, very small beginnings. So let's come back again to this wondrous truth from the first part of the parable. Jesus told his disciples that the kingdom would begin very small. But it is blessed because he is most blessed over all. His word is blessed. His spirit is blessed. His life and his work. Everything he uttered were energized and owned by the spirit of the living God. And the parable of the sower reveals its power in the good soil of 30 and 60 and 100 fold. In the individuals in which that word was sown. His work and his ministry is like any living thing. It grows and it must grow when in the right environment. Some years ago I was meeting, and this is by way of illustration, I was at a meeting of a committee of management in another church. There was a very large piece of ground on the path next to the church, but it was on a steep hill. One of the members of the committee who had a professional role in the building industry and an expert in all things building, said that it was pointless to try growing grass there because it would never grow. So I dumped grass clippings on it over several months and watered it at the same time. And then the storm season came, and within a year and a half, 2 years, the hill was completely covered. From a small patch of transplanted carpet grass, which is regarded by many as weed, that lawn grew into a lovely covering of a hill. But there are many examples, and they abound. One seed, as we know, is enough to produce a harvest of millions of potentially, and so it would be with the kingdom, as we now know. The disciples were to be encouraged as they are about to embark upon a mission not just to the whole world, but for the whole of history. They would go out in twos and win a convert here and a family there. They would plant and they would water and they would plant some more. And from tiny beginnings, Christian ministries grew because God blessed them and multiplied them in the end. The vision of Daniel involved a small stone cut out of the mountain with our hands, and yet one day it would be a stone that would cover the earth. And that is where we now go in this parable, from the small beginnings to the mighty destiny that's captured in the image of a large tree. So, did you know that in the world today, the visible kingdom of God now officially constitutes 2.4 billion Christians? Even if we take a figure of 120 persons on the day of Pentecost as committed Christian followers, that is an extraordinary growth. Our Lord's parable, of course, was always a prophecy, a window into the future. I'm not sure of the maths of a comparison between the volume of an acorn and the final mass of an oak tree, but it would be very large. And yet this growth in the church is far larger than that, by orders of magnitude. So our Lord pictured of the growth of the future kingdom, and he said, "But when it is grown, it is greater than the herbs and becomes a tree." So here is success in the process of growing. And here is the encouragement for the disciples. Their work will ultimately result in something very, very large. It will become something of great stature and of great usefulness and effectiveness, as we will see in our final point. Historically, we have this, as I mentioned, with the visible kingdom that is now the biggest society in the world by a long way. Kenneth Scott Lartaret, who's a historian, once described church history in terms of great advances and lesser retreats. He used the illustration of the tides at certain times of the year. Yes, they ebb and flow, but at certain times of the year, the high tides get higher and the low tides get higher. It's part of the cycle. In the world of investing, the price of shares and other tradable products on the market, they talk about a bull run being marked by higher highs and lower lows. Dr. Lartaret sees this through history as a historian. I don't have the phases, but he did comment on the tidal movements as advances and retreats. And he said that in the last couple of advances and retreats, they are getting shorter and they are moving more quickly than they did in the first part of the church's history. Now let me take you to Daniel 2:44, the famous and popular verse for those who, like me, believe that the world is actually going to get better and that the influence of the gospel is going to get stronger and the size of the church will get larger and larger with the kingdom. So far, over 190 years since Pentecost, the church has at this time, reached in Europe and the ancient Near East and Africa a near domination of the world from time to time. And this was particularly true in the Middle Ages. Currently, she represents more than one third of the world's population. She is a great tree among trees numerically. Why? Because, as I said, she is energized and blessed by God. No, she is not perfect. She has her flaws, serious flaws in some denominations and some nations. But the visible kingdom is what the Lord said would be mighty numerically, as a visible entity. Listen to Charles Ellicott explain the detail of the parable here. He said, "The seed in this case is not so much the word as the Christian society, the church, which forms, so to speak, the first fruits of the word. As it was on the day of Pentecost, it was smaller than any sect or party in Palestine or Greece or Italy. It was sown in God's field of the world, but it was to grow till it became greater than any sect or school, a tree among trees in the forest, a kingdom among other kingdoms, a great and organized society." And he points to Ezekiel 31:3 and Daniel 4:10. Now let me go further here. This is the reason why I'm optimistic about the future. The scriptures, it seems to me, do speak of a time of trouble at the end of this, at the end of history. Very few scholars of any persuasion argue that. However, there are those who say that the world is getting darker and darker and more evil in preparation for the alleged Antichrist and the so-called Battle of Armageddon. However, this parable in Daniel 2:44 with Nebuchadnezzar's dream tell me otherwise. History tells me otherwise. The gospel, its power, and its effects tell me otherwise. In fact, Genesis 1:26-28 tells me otherwise. The tide, I believe, is surging again. And I believe it will come in further this time than it has in the past, as Lateret has observed, the so-called higher high tide. And the great tree that is the kingdom, that is over 35% of the world's population, I believe will grow even bigger in the near to medium future. If the past is any guide, and if this prophetic parable continues in its stunning fulfillment in history. Dr. Nigel Lee wrote a booklet called The Great Straight Planet Earth, and in it he provides 389 Bible verses which confirm the eventual domination of Christian influence over the planet's people and culture. He wrote the book in response to a popular bestseller at the time called The Late Great Planet Earth by an American writer named Hal Lindsey. In it, Mr. Lindsey predicted the arrival of the Antichrist and the increasing collapse of the planet into evil and the return of Christ by the year 1988. What has happened in the world since is that the rate of poverty on our planet has been slashed from 30% of the world's population to 10% in the first part of this century. The church in China now has more members than there are members of the Communist Party. The Christian faith is now undergoing a dramatic resurgence in Europe in association with the rise of the nationalist populist movements. The Russian government, like several European governments, are actively and financially supporting the revival of their local Christian churches. None of this you will read in the media. Most theologians and scholars and schools of prophecy like Mr. Lindsey are pessimistic about the world before Christ's return. There are a few schools of prophecy, however, that are optimistic. And this parable suggests to me, with the history so far in terms of Dr. Lateret, that the optimists are in fact reading scripture correctly. Perhaps I could give you a few of those scripture quotes from Dr. Lee's work to help encourage you that the prophetic parable of the mustard tree in fact speaks of a time in the future, often called a golden age of worldwide Christian influence, and that it will in fact be reality. I quote first from Genesis 1:28. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and over every living thing that moves on the face of the earth. It's called the Dominion Charter, Dominion Theology. That is our call. We are called to fill and subdue the whole earth. And then there is Daniel 2:43 with the defeat of the four great pre-Christian kingdoms represented by the statue of the four metals and the rise of the kingdom of God represented by the white stone. Listen carefully. You watched, O king, while a stone was cut without hands, which struck the image on its feet of iron and clay and broke them in pieces. Then the iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver and the gold were crushed together. It became like chaff from the summer threshing floors, and the wind carried them away so that no trace of them was ever found. And the stone that struck the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. What of Isaiah 11:9? For the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. And here's one from the lips of the Saviour, Matthew 28:20. Our mandate. Jesus came and spoke to them saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations. Throughout these historical advances, as Dr. Lateret calls them, great advances are also made as the influence of the kingdom of God comes to bear on human existence. The Protestant Reformation, of course, brought not only the gospel, but as some of you should know, it brought advances in medicine, and the establishment of universities and education, and a great surge in missionary endeavour, which also spread the blessings of the knowledge of God and the gospel. There is a book written by the Brethren scholar F.F. Bruce on the early church and its dramatic advance, the title of which tells the story. It's called The Spreading Flame. God will make sure that it burns across the world, not only subduing the earth, but rolling back the effects of human sin. And the battles against disease, the undoing of damage done by human abuse, the proper management and control of creation's resources, and many other great tasks in the restoration and the renewal and of creation under God's lordship will be done, as they are being done. As the church grows also, so her influence grows, and with that comes what the Hebrews call shalom, or flourishing. So the great spreading tree is appointed not only to the growth of the kingdom in hard statistical terms, but also to its growth in its blessed influence. So let's finish off this evening by considering that aspect of this glorious little prophetic parable as we look at the blessed legacy of the parable. As we all know, whenever the gospel, or wherever the gospel and the true church goes, there go God's blessings. It is a part of the outworking of the covenant, especially when we think of Abraham and those famous words of Genesis 12, 1-3. Now the Lord said to Abram, "Get out of your country, from your family, from your father's house. Go to a land that I will show you. And I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great. And you shall be a blessing," that is, to others. "And I will bless those who bless you," that's how, "and I will curse those who curse you. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed." Think of the words of Jeremiah in that famous heartwarming section of Jeremiah 29, particularly verse 7, where he says to the people, "Seek the peace of the city where I have caused you to be carried away captive, and pray to the Lord for it, for its peace will be your peace." The Lord is prophesying here that the kingdom, wherever it goes, will be a blessing to all kinds of people. Think of it as at an individual level regarding the call to be salt and light. God's people make the world a more palatable place to live in, salt. They bring the blessing of the light, which is the knowledge of the gospel, the law of God, the wisdom of God, and the love of God. The great tree of the kingdom on earth is a place of healing and help. If it's faithful, and its effects are not just local, not just national, but international. So Charles Ellicott explains again as he talks about the meaning of the birds and the blessing that the birds have in the tree. He said the birds of the air, no longer as in earlier parables, emblems of evil, were to find refuge under its protection. History has witnessed many fulfillments of the prophecy implied in the parable. And those who believe that the life of Christendom is an abiding life will look for yet more blessings. This is why I am positive and I am optimistic about the future and the future of the world. Compare the cultures where the gospel has gone already with the cultures where it has not. Most cultures, not all, that do not have the influence of the gospel, without the presence of the visible kingdom and the church, have few, if any, of the benefits and blessings of the Christian West. There are non-religious analysts and commentators now who are seeing Christian influence disappear from the places where it has gone. They speak of the Judean Christian ethic disappearing and the values, especially human dignity, disappearing with it. And look what takes its place when the kingdom is not present. Consider the city of Portland, where recently Bibles were burned, churches were attacked, violence and lawlessness reigned supreme. In terms of the blessedness of the tree, or the lack of the tree in a society, Richard Dawkins, that rabid atheist and hostile critic of Christianity, once said, "I may not agree with Christian beliefs, but I worry about what replaces it if it goes." No, the great tree of the kingdom of God is a place where people, any people, and many people can come and find God and find peace and find purpose and others who even don't do that still benefit by its presence. Wherever the church goes, it is the salt of the earth as a faithful church. It makes the society and the culture in which it flourishes a more palatable, a more bearable, and a more pleasant place to live. People and societies that come under its blessed influence are blessed, are benefited in so many ways. The great Anglican writer and preacher J.C. Ryle puts it this way concerning the blessedness of the kingdom of God for a nation who comes under its branches. He said, "Which are the countries on the face of the globe at this moment where there is the greatest amount of idolatry or cruelty or tyranny or sexual impurity or corrupt government or disregard of life and truth and liberty? Precisely those countries where the Bible is not known. They've never been under the blessed shade of the great tree that is the kingdom. The blessed influence of the kingdom of God, the manifestation of it in the church of Jesus Christ, the glorious sound of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the sight of the law of God. The great white stone of Daniel 2:44 has grown, but it has not yet covered those parts of the earth. But be assured it will, for the prophet has said so." My question to you tonight, by way of personal application here, is have you nested, not rested, but have you nested in the branches of the great tree, the kingdom of God? Are you obeying the call to repent of your sins and trust in Jesus Christ's death to clear the debt that you owe to God for those sins? Do you know the sunshine of God's love as a father as you nestle in the branches of that great tree that is the kingdom? Do you know the blessed influences of the Holy Spirit in your personal life as part of the life in the branches of the great tree? Are you growing in the understanding of the mysteries of God that have been revealed in Scripture, which reveal your God and His will for your life? So again I ask, are you nesting in the branches of the great tree of the kingdom without the fear of death and confident of eternal life? If you are not, and Jesus bids you come, dear friend, and embrace Him now and forever, and nest in that tree. For it was Jesus Himself who planted that great tree. He sowed it with the Word of God. He gave it life through His death, and now its branches reach all over the world, nominally so far to 2.4 thousand million people. So no, Graham was right, the kingdom never gets smaller. Its inhabitants in heaven and earth will continue to fill up the sum total of God's elect people in history. From the tiniest demographic beginnings, in Jesus Himself, it is built into a tree that holds now on heaven and earth probably more than 3,000 million people, and it will continue to grow until it holds enough people to fill fully the new earth. So again I ask, do you have a secure place in its branches, and are you enjoying it through a genuine and living faith in Jesus Christ? Are you nesting in the tree permanently through a personal covenant with the Lord, confirmed by your baptism and reaffirmed by your partaking of the Lord's Supper? I trust it is so, because in the end there is no better place to nest. Let's pray. Again, we thank you, our Father, for opening our eyes to the future. And we thank you for helping us to see the past. We are so often discouraged by the things that we see in the church itself. But often it's because we do not know where you are working. We think that we are the only ones left, but in fact there are still 7,000 that we do not know about that have not yet bowed the knee to the Baal of the present religions and philosophies and ideologies. And we thank you most of all for the gospel of your Son Jesus Christ, which we own, which has saved us and which has brought us into that glorious kingdom and saved us out of death. So we pray that as we go from this place, that again you would secure this truth in our heart, that we would never be discouraged when it seems the church is failing or faltering or it seems small. but that we would remember the bigger picture as it comes through this parable of the mustard seed. And we ask it in our Lord Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's sing a rousing hymn which speaks of all of this. I cannot tell, 127.
Thank you.
and now the God of peace, who brought up our Lord Jesus from the dead, a great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you complete in every good work to do his will, and working in you what is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory for ever and ever.